Today, let's learn how McCormick's got its start on this episode of Antique Bottle Stories. Willoughby M. McCormick was born in Dover, Virginia in 1864. At age 14, he went to live in Texas with some relatives, and he went to work as a clerk in a general store. A few years later, at age 25, in 1889, McCormick came to settle in Baltimore to start a little tea and spice shop. He started out very small, selling door to door. His first place was on Hanover and Lombard Street, which would have looked nothing like this. And it consisted of one small room and a cellar, plus a very small backyard, which was used for storage. During the first few months, he employed two girls and a guy, and a little later, two more girls. During this period, Willoughby was both manufacturer and sales. His products included root beer, flavored extracts, fruit syrups, and juices. They were sold under B brand, which he used for a very long time. Other products made at this time were iron glue, sticks to everything but the buyer. What's interesting to me is that this is an ad from 1953, so that's at least 60 years they made this glue. Did you ever know that McCormick's made glue? And another product was Uncle Sam's nerve and bone liniment for man and beast. So, as you can see, he was kind of all over the board at this time, no doubt trying to figure out what the customers wanted. By 1890, the company was growing rapidly and had moved to a four-story building. They added food colors, household drugs, and lubricating oils to their product line. In 1896, the F.G. Emmett Spice Company of Philadelphia was bought by McCormick. All the machinery was shipped to Baltimore. That same year, the first McCormick cookbook was published, and the first premium was offered. The premium was the Little Puck Lamp, a perfume bottle slash night lamp slash toy combined. It was yours for three labels from McCormick Wild Cherry Tonic. Willoughby McCormick worked tirelessly from morning till late at night. When people asked what his ambition was, he replied, "Make the best, someone will buy it." Within a short time, he discovered that someone was buying his products, actually a little faster than he could make them. Between 1891 and 1903, the business expanded and moved seven times. McCormick had more than he could handle, and he convinced his brother Roberto to join the firm. In 1903, Willoughby and his brother Roberto incorporated the company in Maine. It was reincorporated in Maryland in 1915. Most of the company's assets and records were destroyed in the Great Baltimore Fire of February 1904. Over 2 days, it burned most of the business district, including some new skyscrapers that were in progress. Willoughby wrote, "I had built up my business until it was the largest of its kind in the United States, and now it's the smallest of the small." However, a new five-story building was erected on the same site within 10 months in 1905. They added a few new items to their product line, and in 1910, they were the first to introduce tea in tea bags like we know today. Willoughby married twice. His first wife died in 1903, and he never had any children with either wife. Willoughby's nephew, Charles P. McCormick, began working for the company in the summer of 1912 while he was in high school. After going to college, he joined the sales force full-time in 1919 in Richmond, Virginia. Then he was elected to the company board of directors in 1925. In 1915, Willoughby sponsored sales conventions, issued a series of books on spices and cooking, and encouraged the public to visit his factory. In 1921, the McCormick factory moved to a nine-story building on the Baltimore Harbor. Willoughby remained the president of McCormick & Company for 42 years until his sudden death of a heart attack on November 4, 1932, at the age of 69. Before Willoughby's death, he had donated over $100,000 and other gifts to the Baptist Home for the Aged. He was also the organizer and the president. The Baptist home had started with five widows in 1917. Willoughby also donated money to the Baptist Children Aid Society for orphaned and neglected children. At the time of his death, he was involved in many organizations: president of the Virginians of Maryland, director of the Baltimore Criminal Justice Commission, the Baltimore Association of Commerce, the Maryland Casualty Company, the First National Bank of Baltimore, and Old Bay Line Steamship Company. He was also the founder of the University Baptist Church and a member of the board of the Salvation Army. There are actually more organizations he was involved with, but you get the gist. When Willoughby died, his nephew Charles was elected president and chairman of the board at age 36. His uncle Willoughby had been known as kind of a hard employer, working his workers long hours, and with the Depression in full swing, he had cut wages twice already. So Charles implemented his philosophy of multiple management. Working hours were cut, which had been close to 60-hour work weeks at this point. Wages were raised 10%, and junior and factory boards were established. Employees were given a say in how things were run, and every employee was given a free turkey for Thanksgiving, which is still done to this day. In 1941, the big MC, as we know it today, became a trademark for the U.S. products. In 1946, McCormick issued its first annual report. That same year, McCormick merged with a spice and extract house called A. Schilling & Company of San Francisco. This enabled McCormick to begin coast-to-coast distribution in the United States. During World War II, McCormick supported the troops by supplying a variety of products, from mustard and mayonnaise to tea. At the Army's request, the company also built a potato dehydration plant in Maine, which supplied potatoes to troops abroad. In 1928, McCormick had reached the $5 million mark. By 1961, they reached the $50 million mark. And by 1969, they reached the $100 million mark. And today, they're over $4 billion. Charles's son, Charles Jr., otherwise known as Buzz, was elected president and CEO in 1987. The company celebrated 100 years in 1989. Buzz has since retired to Florida, and a guy named Robert Lawless is now president. Buzz says he doesn't know if another McCormick will ever lead the business again, but who knows? I have three McCormick bottles, all different time frames. One is blown in the mold, with a tooled top, so this one would actually date before 1920, so Willoughby would have been alive when this one was manufactured. I have one machine-made one, with no date, so it dates anywhere between the 20s and probably the 40s. Look at the differences in the tops. And I have one amber bottle, with a date stamped of 1938 on the bottom, with the ridges on the sides. This would have been a B brand extract, just like this one. And that's all I've got for today. Thanks for watching, guys. We'll see you next time.